Turn, if you will, to the book of Psalms. Book of Psalms, Psalm 42. A familiar passage of scripture to some, and maybe not at all familiar to others, but God has a word for us today. I promise you, I just need you to give me a few good amens, and we're going to be out of here, but God has prepared a word for us today that is just for new life. It is like no other, and I'm so grateful. I'm excited all over again. You would think I already know what the message is, but I know what the end of this thing is, and I'm still excited. I thank God. Thank God so much. Psalms 42. We'll begin reading at verse number 1. When you have it, say amen.
Amen.
All right. Somebody share with the young people. I see some young people that don't have a Bible. Somebody move across the aisle if you ain't too ashamed. Move to somebody that doesn't have a Bible. Share your phone. Share your Bible. Everybody needs to see the Word of God. And the young people, they read gooder than us, so get to them. Get to them so they can see. There's a whole row of people don't have no Bible. Get to where they are. Word of God is important. It is so important. It is so important. All right, Book of Psalms. Are we there? Amen. We'll begin reading in verse number 1. As the deer pants for the water, so pants my soul for you, O God. My soul thirsts for God, for the living God. But when shall I come and appear before God? My tears have been my food day and night, while they continually say to me, where is your God now? When I remember these things, look at this, I pour out my soul within me, for I used to go with the multitude. I went with them to the house of God with voice of joy and praise, with a multitude that kept a pilgrim feast. But as for me, I am poor and needy. May the Lord think of me. You are my help and my deliverer. You are my God. Yeah. Do not delay. Listen to this in the New Living Translation. Psalm 42, verse 1. As the deer longs for streams of water, so I long for you, O God. I thirst for God, the living God. When can I go and stand before God? Day and night, I have only tears for food, while my enemies, unsaved folks, continually taunt me. Y'all got any taunters at work, any taunters on your job, taunters in your family? While enemies continually taunt me, saying, where is your God now? My heart is breaking, but as I remember how it used to be. Yeah, some of us need to remember how it used to be. He says, I used to walk among the crowds of worshipers, leading a great procession to the house of God. See, some of y'all used to go with a praise on your lips, singing for joy and giving thanks and the sound of a great celebration. I used to do. But where is your God now? They are taunting him. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Where is your God now? But David says, even though my heart is breaking, I remember when it didn't used to be this way. Let us pray. Father God, we come before you now with this great preaching moment, this preaching hour. God, we come to magnify you. We come to glorify you because you are God, and there is none other like you in all of the world. God, we come now because you said that we should not forsake the assembling of the saints. God, we stand before you now because we are in need of something. God, we need you to speak to us right now. Speak to us, God, right where we stand. God, we have some trials and tribulations that are just lurking around the corner. God, we can't see them. We don't know what they are. God, we have not the ability, but we know that you are an able God. We know that you're able to see around corners and over heels and underneath. God, we ask now that you would give us a word today that would help us to go through the rest of this week, knowing that you are God and beside you there is none other. Have your way in this place, God. I ask now that you would decrease me, that you would increase in me, God, that you would have your way, that you would speak now, God. You declared that your word would go out and it would not return unto you void. Have your way now in this place. God, open our hearts and our minds to receive what thus say you. We need you now like never before. God, have your way in this place. Save with your word. Deliver with your word. Sanctify, heal today with your word, God. We need you now. Lord, we've been praying for this word. God, we've been asking for this word, and we need you now to just deliver on who you are. Just show up in this place and be God. We thank you now. We magnify you in the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Say this for me. I have a yet praise. You'll get it in a second, but say it already like you mean it. I have a yet praise. Say it like I wrote it. I got a yet praise. I got a yet praise. Days of old, days of old, days of old, days of old sometimes motivate you into new days of your life. The days of old, you ought to be able to think back to where you used to be. I wasn't there, but I know some of you that sit before me today, you remember the days of old. Some of y'all remember picking cotton and being in the fields all day and all night and milking cows and grandmama used to say slopping hogs and all of that kind of stuff. Well, I wasn't there, but thank you for your hog slopping, and thank you for your cotton picking, and thank you for your peanut shelling and all that you've done. I thank you for that. But sometimes we ought to be able to just think back to what God has already done. We read now, the psalmist said, when I think back, I might be in a bad place now. He said, but it ain't always been this way. He said, I remember a time when things were just a little bit better. And in this life, I declare that between our teenage years and our adult years, we go through some changes. Anybody go through some changes between your teenage years and your adult years? I know you like the teenagers to believe that you've always had it together, but you ain't always been this saved. Your skirts ain't always been that long. Okay, right, Deacon Boone, that they skirts ain't always been that long. We remember when there were somebody in here, you ain't got to say who you were, but somebody had a pair of hot pants. Oh, hallelujah, she admitted. And mother, you had some too. Oh, bless the Lord. That's why she's super saved today, because she had some hot pants. And God had to save her in her hot pants. Bless the Lord. You don't have them now, do you? Don't answer that. Don't answer that. But we ought to be able to. We ought to be able to think back to the days of old and understand that we experienced some things as teenagers that some of us, if we're honest, we never want to experience some of those things again. We went through some things as teenagers that we never want to go through again. And then at the same time, there are those experiences that made a lasting impression in a good way, not in a bad way, in a good way that we would not mind repeating. Some people, even here today, might remember in your teens, you had your, you ain't got to look at nobody, just look at me, and won't nobody know I'm talking but me and you. You might have had your first kiss as a teenager. One of the ushers, she just thought about who she kissed, and she got excited all over again. I see you. We had our first kiss, and then some of you had your first date. You had your first date, your first boyfriend, your first girlfriend. In our teens, we learned first then how, anybody learn how to drive when you were a teenager? Some of y'all even younger than that, right? Because you had to drive the tractor, right? I know. We learned how to drive as teenagers and how to wash our own clothes and how to iron. I was talking to my sister-in-law yesterday about how well she and my brother have done with their children, because at their tender ages, I thought it was tender, but they know how to iron and wash their clothes. I'm going to tell this story. I started washing my own clothes not because I had to, not because mama told me to, but I had a favorite sweatshirt that was red and gray. Sweatshirt was on point. I paid a lot of money for that sweatshirt. I believe I got it at Kmart, and it cost me almost $19. And I thought y'all knew. And so I had my favorite sweatshirt, and my mother, bless her heart, she does good, but she hadn't read the label. And on the label, it said that it needs to be washed in cold water by itself. And mama wasn't paying attention. And she just threw it in with everything else. And my sweatshirt that was gray and had the red strip on it, when it came out, it was pink. And I said, got to be more careful. Because I was mad about it, right? And she ain't never heard this story. She know now. And I said, I'm determined to learn how to wash my own self clothes. And from that day to this day, bless you, mama, been washing my own self stuff because I didn't want another pink sweatshirt. So we ought to be able to think back to the things we used to do. And some things ought not be repeated. I ain't got nothing pink that ain't supposed to be pink. Hallelujah, because I learned a lesson. So I thank God for that. But Thank you, Mama. Y'all gonna have to walk me out. She's gonna be mad about that. You remember the first person that you broke up with, or they broke up with you. We experienced our first mishaps in learning, watch this, how to kiss, or the proper etiquette for dating. We experienced some issues in learning the process. We learned that not everybody we call our friend really was a friend. We learned that Uncle Joe really wasn't Uncle Joe. We learned that your cousin really wasn't your cousin, but your cousin was your sister, because they sent somebody off to have a baby. When they came back, they told you that it was somebody else, and then you found out that that really was who you were related to. I know you know this. You didn't want to tell nobody, but now we know. If you're honest, in those years, we had some good and some bad experiences. We had some highs and some lows. We had some good times and some bad times. And then in our adult years, things really haven't changed all that much. But we had some similar experiences. And I'm just a little bit older, but still, I go through some things. We still have, even at some of the ripe old ages we are now, we still have some relationship issues. We still have some driving issues. Some of y'all have rear-ended some people, or you've been rear-ended yourself. You still ain't mastered driving. I know I haven't. We still experience heartache and breakups, and life still has its highs and lows and its ups and downs. And how many saints, if you're honest, you can say that my life I have has had some mountaintop experiences? Anybody been high on the mountain? You've had some really good times. You had the birth of some children, and you had your marriage, and you had your baptism, and you had your salvation. We had some mountaintop experiences, but here's what I have to tell you. I always been on a mountaintop experience. I've also when I seemingly had it all, I've been on the mountaintop. Yes, I had the right person in my life. I had the right career. You had the right bank account. You had the children were acting right, and everybody at church liked you, and you had the best car that money could buy. I undoubtedly had, you've had some mountaintop experiences, but at the same time, if I'm honest, I gotta tell you that I have had some valley experiences as well. Somebody said, my life ain't been no crystal stair. There have been some highs and some lows. I've been in the valley. The old folks used to say it like this: I've been so low that I've been almost level to the ground. I've been down so low that I've been able to play handball on the curb. That's how low some of us have been. When nobody would come around, these were my valley experiences. Old folks used to say, well, you didn't have two nickels to rub together. Y'all remember that? That's a valley experience. I didn't have a significant other. Children were acting up, and your spouse was even sleeping in another room. The doctors were coming for you and left a bad report for you and what's going on with your body. All kinds of bad news. You were unemployed or underemployed. In this life, we have had some valley experiences. Well, as we eavesdrop now on this psalmist today, in Psalms 42, this division of the Psalms, we can see that David notes that as the deer pants for the water, he says that the deer needs water, just like the deer desires the water. God, I desire you, so I, Lord, desire you. The psalmist cries out, Lord, when can I meet you? When can I come and see God? For some reason, the Bible doesn't say why, but for some reason, this psalmist could not get to God. He could not get to where God is. And let me just help you understand what was happening. So often in the Old Testament times, they would localize God. In other words, they didn't feel like they were close to God unless they went to the synagogue. They didn't feel like they were close to God unless they went to church. So that's why he felt like, I can't get to God. In other words, there was something keeping him from church. That's why I said you ought to get excited when you get up on a Sunday morning. You're able to make it to the house of the Lord because somebody wanted to be in the synagogue this morning. Somebody wanted to be the church, they couldn't make it, and then you show up, and then you just sit there with your pompous self and not want to clap when somebody says clap, not want to give God praise when you know that's what you owe him. So this brother was having a hard time because he said, when am I going to be able to get to God? Now watch this. The psalmist, like many of us, was in what seemed to be a valley experience in his life. Because this is the same David who lifted up holy hands to God. This is the same David who proclaimed that God is my strength and my refuge. Well, what do you do when life knocks you down, when you find out that you are in yet another valley experience? What do you do when your Bible-toting self, when your new life-attending self, when your scripture-quoting self, when God seems like you are yet in another valley experience and God is not doing anything for you? What do you do when it seems like life once again has knocked you down? What do you do? How do you get through that when life is hard yet again? You call yourself a child of God. You call yourself a believer. You call yourself a Jesus follower. Well, what do you do when life gets in the way and things don't be seeming to go as planned? Oh, remember David. when he had a mountaintop experience. David said, when he was high on the mountain, David said, "The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures." That was a mountaintop experience for David. That just sounds like a mountaintop experience. David also wrote, "The Lord is my light and my salvation. Of whom shall I fear? Whom shall I be afraid?" Those were all mountaintop experiences. David also wrote, "In the time of trouble, he shall hide me in the secret place of his tabernacle." Those are all mountaintop experiences. But watch this. In this psalm, David starts out by saying, "I'm thirsty for you, Lord. My tears, my tears, my tears have become food for me day and night." Then David says, "When can I meet you, Lord?" Anybody ever feel like you need to have a meeting with God? Anybody other than me, you ever feel like, "Lord, it don't seem like you understand what's going on with me. God, it just seems like you don't quite get all of the stuff that I'm going through." They said cancer on Monday, and then I heard cancer again 2 weeks later. And then my children are not acting right, and my finances are in trouble. It just doesn't seem, "Lord, I need to have a one-on-one conference call with you, because it just doesn't seem like you understand what I'm going through. I don't know if, Lord, if you really know how I feel. Lord, I need to meet with you one-on-one so you can understand my lot in life." David says, "I've been up, but right now, Lord, I'm down. I'm having a valley experience, and I need you now, Lord, like never before." Many of you can attest to this. You've been on roller coaster rides, right? And your roller coaster ride will take you up and down and around curves, and some you can see and some you can't see. And it just seems like the ride is never going to end. And the Bible says, watch this, in verse number 4, David says, after he's having this valley experience, then he says, "These things I remember as I pour out my soul. I recall that I used to go to the house of God. I used to shout for joy and praise the Lord. I used to go," watch this, "to New Life and lift up holy hands. I used to go to New Life and sing with great joy. I used to go to New Life and dance with the other saints." Y'all thought I was going to leave you out. I'm not leaving you out. In those days, he says, here's what the psalmist is saying. "I used to have more than I have now. I used to laugh more than I do now. I used to love more than I do now. I used to be happier than I am now." And if life was not bad enough, the psalmist says already, his enemies now are starting to mess with him. In verse number 3, the Bible says, they said to David, "Look at your life. All hell is breaking loose, and your job ain't what you thought it was going to be, and your friends don't come around like they used to, and those folks that you used to call friends, now you can't find them, and won't nobody return your text message, and won't nobody return your voice message, and won't nobody Facebook you. You sad now." And then they said, "Where is your God now? When you're looking crazy like you're looking, you're angry all the time. Where is your God now? You mad all the time and ain't nobody even done nothing to you. Where is your God now? You don't have what you want. Where is your God? You depressed all the time. Where is your God?" David says, "Well, let me just help you out. I ain't always been depressed. I remember a time when I was broke. I remember a time when I was not broke. I remember a time when I did not enjoy life, but also remember a time when I did enjoy life." David says, "I remember a time when I used to love my spouse. I've not always been sad. I used to be glad." A songwriter said it like this: "I've had some good days and I've had some bad days. I've had some hills to climb. I've had some weary days and even had some sleepless nights." But here's where it gets exciting for David. But David says, "But when I look around and I think things over, I have got to declare that my good days have showed up outweighing my bad days." And then the songwriter says, I won't complain. So I just came to tell you today, New Life, you ought to get excited. You know why you ought to get excited? This is just for the broke folks in the room. You ought to get excited because this ain't your first time being broke. I thought you knew. But the last time you were broke, God messed around and sent $1 or $2 to your bank account. This ain't the first time you've been sick. Because the last time you were sick, God messed around and sent a healing your way. This ain't the first time you've been depressed. You ought to take your meds if that's what the doctor said. But the last time
You were depressed. God showed up and he was the lifter of your head. So let me just help you out. If you came in today and you depressed, if you came in today and you sad, if you came in today and you broke, don't get messed up, busted, and disgusted. Just say to yourself, oh, when I look back over my life and I think things over, this ain't the first time I've been broke. This ain't the first time I ain't had no car. This ain't the first time. So just as you trusted God the last time, the same God back then, same God right now. Yesterday, today, and forevermore. Let me help you again. He's the same God. Yesterday, today, and you're going to get in a second. He's the same God. Yesterday, today, and forevermore. If he blessed you last month, he'll bless you this month. If he blessed you last year, he'll bless you this year. If he blessed you when you were born, he'll bless you when you were a teenager. If he blessed you in your teenage years, he'll bless you in your adult years. If he blessed you in your adult years, he'll bless you on the other side. This ain't your first time, so you ought to just tell God, thank you. This ain't my first time being in this place. Oh, God is a good God. God is a good God. David said, oh, don't get it twisted. Yeah, life is a roller coaster ride, but I ain't always been like this. David said, I can remember a time when things were just a little bit better. David said, I remember a time when I had a few more dollars. I remember a time when I could run a marathon. Now I can't run to the kitchen, but I remember a time. Oh, you ought to be glad. Let me help you like this. We may be experiencing some valleys right now, but God has been good to me. Oh, God has smiled on me. I said it earlier. Sister Sophie used to say, if he hasn't been good to you, you ought to thank him anyway, because we ought to show up on Sunday morning to do what? Rock Daniel. Come on now, Rock Daniel with me today, because God has been good. Don't you mess around and let a few valley experiences tear you down. God has been good to you. And God has been good to me. Let me help you right here, and I'm going to take my seat. He woke you up this morning. Grandmama used to say it. He started you on your way. Come on, you help. You had the same grandmama. Just help me preach. When I rose this morning, old folks used to say, I had the activity of my, okay, y'all know, I had the activity of my limb. Then they messed around and said, I had a reasonable portion of what? Y'all got it right. My health and strength. That's what lets me know that God has been good to me. Like the psalmist, when life gives you a bad blow, sometimes you won't have to think yourself back to a mountaintop experience. Watch this. You won't have to think yourself back to when things were better. The Bible says, right there in verse number 4, that he had to think about. He said, I had to remember, because the enemy tried to get me in, and I had to think about how good God had already been. Watch this. And then the Bible says in verse number 5, David had to talk to himself. Now I know what the doctor said, and they say you ain't supposed to talk to yourself. But I just believe that the Bible is right. If David talked to himself, then I'm going to give you permission today. You can talk to yourself. Just be careful what you say back to yourself. But you ought to be able to talk to yourself. Ain't nothing wrong with having a little talk with you. At least you won't get interrupted by nobody else talking. And at least nobody won't interrupt you if ain't nobody talking but you and you. David said in verse number 5, watch this. So, he talking to himself, S-O-U-L. David said, so, why are you so downcast? Why are you so disturbed? And here it is right here. The Bible says, put your hope in God. Watch this. For I will yet. You missed it. That was your shout right there. David said, for I will yet praise him. Why? Because he's my Savior. He's my God. Watch this. Yes, life has been ups and downs. Yes, life has had me on an emotional roller coaster. Yes, life has tried to beat me up from time to time. Yes, I've had some mountaintop experiences, and yes, I've had some valley low experiences. But watch this. Don't leave the text. Don't leave the text. Don't leave the text. Don't leave the text too soon out there. The Bible says that David got happy all over again when he talked to himself. He said, so put your hope in God. Read it. It's right there. David was talking to himself. Wasn't nobody else around. David said, soul. He's talking to his soul. Put your hope in God, for I will yet praise him. Here it is. We really are going home. Psalms 42 and Psalms 43 are connected. All right. So when we leave Psalm 42 and then we show up at Psalm 43, because let me tell you, how do you get from Psalm 42 to Psalm 43? You flip the page. I didn't want you to miss it. So Psalm 43, they go together. David has done all this talking and all this remembering. And when David is done, God has not said a word. David is talking to God. And he said, I've had some mountaintop experiences. I've had some valley experiences. He's asking for God's help. I got disappointed for a quick second when I got to the end of Division 43, and the Bible didn't say that God said a word. David is doing all this crying. David is doing all this complaining. And God didn't say nothing. Let me help you, New Life. How is it that you, a child of God, can do all this talking to God and he doesn't speak? What do you do when you pray and God says nothing? What do you do when you're calling out on God and he says nothing? At least we think he is saying nothing. But watch this. Don't leave the text. Don't leave the text too soon. When we get to Psalm 43, David says, vindicate me, O God. In other words, David says, watch this, three simple words. Fix it, Jesus. I'm going to help you out right about here. We're going to shout and go home. David says, vindicate me, oh Lord. Let me say it like I feel it. David said, I done all that talking and complaining in verse 42. Chapter 42. I did all of this talking and complaining in verse 42 from one verse to the end of the verse. And then I flipped the page, Lord, and I started to complain in chapter 43. But then I remembered that I had always been broke. I remember that I had always been depressed. So as I thought about it, I said, well, let me change my mindset. And David said, vindicate me, O Lord. Let me help you with vindicate. Vindicate simply means fix it, God. So David said, fix it, Jesus. Watch this. David has done all of this talking, and God has not said a mumbling word. No response from God. No words from the Almighty. No encouraging words. No scriptures to be quoted. No pats on the back from God. Well, what do you do when God is silent? Well, David said, God is talking. You just not listening. God is being silent. David says, right now, I can't hear God. I can't get an answer from God. But David finds a way to deal with his life's ups and downs. David finds a way to deal with his valley experiences. David says right here in the Bible, because the Bible says, because I remember I put my hope in God. Let me help you right here, and then I promise you we are going on. Right here, hope in the Bible, in a lot of different places, it means a lot of different things. There's more than just one word, but because we have the English language, and that's what we've mastered, and that's what we work with, and I'm going to work with it this morning, but hope doesn't always mean hope the way we think. Hope means hope. So I did a little bit of study, because I know how you are, and you want to know a little bit more about what hope means. So when David says here, put your hope in God, here is what he means. What David says is, I expect God. Okay, that ought to help you. He said, I expect God to do some great things. So here, David, when he says, put your hope in God, what David is saying is, expect God to do some great things. Expect God. In other words, I know God enough to know that on today, I know he ain't said nothing. But today, I expect a miracle. I know God ain't said nothing, but when I woke up this morning, I said, today, I expect a blessing. I know enough about God that when I got up this morning, I said, I don't know what's going to happen today, but I expect God to show up and show out. I expect God. Why? Because I remember when life was good, because I have a few issues, a few problems, and the one thing that I know that I do have If I ain't got nothing else, I got a yet praise. David had to talk to himself. A yet praise, a yet praise, a yet praise. Good God Almighty. What do you mean about a yet praise, Pastor? How is it that I don't have a yet praise? I'm so glad you asked, Sister Marcella, so I showed up with a yet praise. A yet praise. Here it is. A yet praise. Pastor, what is a yet praise? What is a yet praise? I don't know how to get to a yet praise. I wrote down a few things here, and I'm going to share them with you, and we're going to sing a little ditty, and we're going home. How is it? Good God Almighty. I feel it like I want to feel it. How is it that I got a yet praise? How is it that I have these valley experiences, and then I have a mountaintop experience, then I have another valley experience, then I have another mountain? How is it that I keep going through all this hell, and you telling me that I need to have a yet praise? How I got a yet praise? What a yet praise look like? How do I get to a yet praise? Well, I'm glad you asked, Reverend Hazard. Here it is right here. I don't have the job yet. That ought to be, that's it right there. That ought to be your yet praise. But I will praise God until I start work. My family ain't acting right. Yeah. Okay, there it is right there. Come on now, help me preach. But I got a yet praise. My children ain't acting like they're supposed to, but I got a yet praise. My spouse is still sleeping in the other room, but I got a yet praise. The church folks still won't treat me right. They still talking about, but guess what? I thought about some things, so I got a yet praise. There it is. My money is still funny, but I got a yet. There it is. My body is not healed yet, but I got a yet praise. Why? Because I know enough about God to know that my healing is on its way. I'm almost done. My bank account ain't where it's going to be. But I got a yet praise. I need a touch from God. I ain't healed, but I got a I ain't got my joy back yet. I ain't got my deliverance. I'm still wiping tears away from my eyes, but I got a. I need more faith, so it's coming. Yeah, I got a yet praise in my spirit. I don't know how else to do it. I don't know what else you want me to do, because when I think about what God has already done for me, I find myself in a yet praise. Here it is. I know you don't have it, but you ought to praise God like it's already done. That's your yet praise. I know it's not here yet. I know it's not over yet. I know it's not done yet. I know it's not mine yet. I come to church today on my way home to say, just like this, you came in with some issues this morning. And you might leave with some issues this morning. I didn't solve all your problems in an hour and a half. But you ought to have a yet praise on your lips. Why? Because you ought to think about the goodness of Jesus and everything that he's done for you. And the Bible says that your soul ought to cry out, hallelujah. Why? It's getting late in my situation, but I gotta yet praise. It's raining cats and dogs in my life, but I gotta yet praise. I can't find no help from nobody else, but I gotta yet praise. I can't get no satisfaction, but I gotta yet praise. Come on, tell God, I'm gonna praise you anyhow. It's not done yet, but I'm gonna praise you. David said, I gotta yet praise. How can you get to a yet praise? All you gotta do is think about what the Lord has already done. Think about in 1942 how the Lord blessed you. You owe him a praise. I think about in 1956, I'm coming to your year, how the Lord blessed you. You ought to have a yet praise. How about 1971 when the Lord blessed you? You ought to have, I'm waiting on you to get your yet praise. In other words, you ought to praise him in advance. Don't you wait until your bank account is good. Praise him right now. Don't wait until your health has been restored. Praise him right now. Don't wait until the children act right. Praise him right now. Don't wait until the other one gets saved. You ought to praise him right now. Don't wait. Somebody said it like this. Don't wait until the battle is over. You ought to shout now. Why? Because I got to yet praise. You know why I got to yet praise? All I got to do is look back over my life. Think things over. And all of my good days, I weigh my bad days. And guess what? I won't complain. Instead of complaining, you ought to have a yet praise. I know it ain't done. I know it ain't here. I know it ain't already done. My body ain't healed. I ain't overcome it. My spouse ain't home. I don't have a lover. But I know they're on their way. So you ought to have a yet praise.